Dear Secretary of the Interior, thank you for inviting me to weigh in on this very important counter study to an indefensible claim by the Heritage Society. As you know, this conservative organization is pushing for free enterprise and limited government. So they're merely trying to deregulate to support free enterprise and to help their allies, including industry, save some money. As you know, in 1970, the EPA was formed to control the extreme pollution of water and air in this country. These conditions were causing fish kills, bird die-offs, and having negative effects on human health. Command and control policies such as the Clean Air Act were established also in 1970 to regulate the use of these pollutants. The goal was to protect the ecosystem and human health for future generations, and so far it's been effective. From the point of view of scientists and environmental advocates, it's a success. Pollution has been vastly reduced since the implementation of these policies, and this is a tremendous achievement. So why stop now is our argument. There are still extremely endangered ecosystems in this country, and industries are constantly inventing new products that could have new negative effects on the environment that we're not yet aware of. So the study we conduct to challenge the Heritage Society's claims, we'll have four parts. First, we'll focus on science benchmarks. We'll also focus on public opinion. We'll propose an administrative review of the EPA and a review by the Justice Department. So for our first pillar, the scientific measurements, we'll hire an outside team of environmental scientists to evaluate air and water quality and how it has improved since 1970. Scientists must also prove that threats to the health of our environment, to our clean air and water still exist, and that regulation of anything should be expanded and improved and not reduced or terminated. We need to frame our study to focus on scientific results to counter the Heritage Society's focus on economic results. We will design a study based on science and numbers because that is how you'll measure the efficacy of a program like the Clean Air Act. So focus on how you've improved vehicle emissions, how fish and bird populations have bounced back, and this will help legitimate our study in the eyes of the scientific community, and will also involve the scientific community. We can also come at this from an angle that will satisfy the business community and Congress. We can require companies to maintain certain air quality standards as a means to spur innovation. We've been innovative in this regard so far. We've invented cleaner fuels, renewable energy, and we believe that the American people can invent even better, cleaner technologies, and the regulation will help inspire that. Our second component will focus on the public stance on the issue of environmental protection. We're in an unprecedented era in environmental awareness, and the public is completely behind it. I'd like to bring your attention to a very revealing ruling that just came out in the last few weeks. In Massachusetts, two men used their lobster boat to block a coal shipment from passing through the channel on its way to Brayton Point Power Plant. The men were on trial for several counts and faced several years in jail, and the judge ruled that he approved the use of necessity as a defense for their actions. In order to use the necessity defense, you have to prove that you were in clear and imminent danger. And in this instance, the defense argues the men in their communities were in clear and imminent danger of climate change. So the judge decreed they had no legal alternative to protect themselves and their communities other than to try to block the coal shipment. So the prosecutor subsequently dropped the charges. So obviously this is a totally unprecedented case. This is an exciting time for environmental progressives. Judges are going rogue on this issue and are allowing people a lot of room to maneuver to fight environmental problems. So we want to design a policy review that involves the public energy as much as possible. So we're going to educate the public. We're going to use some of our funding to organize conferences and smaller community advisory committees. These committees will call small meetings in their communities and discuss the EPA's command and control policies, and they can weigh in on whether or not they feel like those policies should continue at this time. This method will give our study legitimacy in the eyes of the public and in the eyes of Congress, who depend on the public for voting. I highly doubt the Heritage Society did a public assessment or reached out to the public in their review, so this will give our study that added legitimacy that we involve the public opinion. And then come election time, the public will play a role in the political evaluation of the Heritage Society's policy suggestions. And we'll also ask the public to consider who the Heritage Society is serving in trying to overturn these important policies. The courts finally ruled that the BP oil spill was the result of gross negligence, and so we can ask, are these the types of behaviors the Heritage Society thinks we no longer need to regulate against? Okay, third component, we're going to play to the business community and to the Heritage Society by holding an administrative review of the EPA. They are arguing against the efficiency of the program, and the EPA has had some organizational problems in the last few decades. So we're going to go ahead and help them out with that, and also a better organized, better running EPA is good for everybody. And that will satisfy the business community also to have some of that, what they see as wasteful practices, reduced. Our fourth review method, like I said, is to involve the Justice Department. And I'll remind you again of the instance of the judge releasing the environmental activists to block the coal barge. So the Justice Department as a whole, we think, should take a stand on this issue of the right to clean air and water. So we're requesting a judicial review of the constitutionality of removing command and control policies designed to protect the people and the environment. So in conclusion, I agree with you, Secretary, that the study by the Heritage Society is bogus, and we need to organize our own review of command and control policies that highlight their value.